And good morning. Glad you could be with us here at Farmington Baptist Church. Always good to see you. And be sure and welcome all of our visitors. I know we always have some visitors, and I'm glad you could be with us and join us this morning as well. So if you would, stand up with us. And I appreciate Jessica filling in for Lisa this morning. Let's start out with Send the Light.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless waves. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And a golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore.
All right, amen. Send the light, send the light. That's exactly what we should do, shouldn't it? Let our light shine. All right, let's continue with To God Be the Glory.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our victory, when Jesus we see. Praise Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory. Great things he hath done.
Amen. You can be seated for just a moment. Brother Ben will come and make the morning announcements for us.
You're in the Lord's house today. Thankful to see each and every one of you here. Beautiful day outside, but we're glad you're inside right now for us this morning. Hope you was able to find a bulletin. Lots of things going on. Let me read to you a card, though, I received. It says, my church family, words cannot express my appreciation of all the meals, the cards, the calls, the texts I've gotten from my church family. Most of all, the prayers for me. Please continue to pray for me. Thank you and love from my heart. And that's from Miss Nancy Lacewell. Let's continue to remember Miss Nancy in our prayers, and we'll put that card on the board, and you be sure to keep praying for Miss Nancy. Remember, again, grab a bullet if you didn't. Should be one there in your pew or around there. Lots of things going on. We're at the last of April, but May is going to be a busy month. So several things going on in the month of May. One thing not in the bulletin, right after the service this morning for just a couple of minutes, I can meet with the deacons back in the back Sunday school room. So deacons meeting right after the service this morning, just a quick one. Next Sunday, graduation day, we've got several graduates, so we'll be honoring our high school graduates next Sunday in the morning service, be presenting all of them a Bible from the church. We're 2 weeks away from Mother's Day, so remember Mother's Day is coming up. We'll have muffins with Mom that morning for all the moms and grandmothers and aunts and all the kids, so remember that on Mother's Day. And Bible school is just a few weeks away, a little different day this week, May the 24th through the 27th. So remember Vacation Bible School. If you would like to help out and sign up to be a part of a Vacation Bible School, there's two different sign-up sheets out there. Lots of different ways you can help out. You can teach. You can be a helper. You can help out in the kitchen. You can help out with games, different things. You can do crafts. There's all sorts of ways to help out in Bible school. I know some of you may not be able to help out the whole week, but if you'd like to help out for part of the week, we'd love to have you help out. So remember Vacation Bible School, the sign-up sheet. Also, there's a tote out there underneath the table in the foyer that we're collecting things for crafts. So you can see Miss Christina Fazy, if you got any questions about that, the list is there in the bulletin. So remember that. A couple other things. Operation Christmas Child, if you would like to help Miss Kim and Miss Joyce with that. I know they've helped out and done that in the past, and they need an additional helper. So maybe you've been looking for a way to get involved in the church. That's one way you could do that. So let me or Miss Kim know if you'd like to help out with Operation Christmas Child. And then if you've got any questions about the church t-ball or softball teams, you see Brother Jamie and let him answer any questions you may have about that this morning. We're glad you're here this morning, and let's pray, ask the Lord to bless us and give us a great day in the Lord's house. Good to see Brother Eugene and Miss Doris back again with us. Brother Eugene, won't you pray for us, if you will, this morning, brother? Brother Greg, you come, brother.
All right, if you would stand back up. Ryan, you're ready, aren't you? Ryan's up, standing up, ready to sing. All right, let's sing Here I Am to Worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Amen. Good job. Good job. All right, let's finish up this morning with a song called In His Time.
In His time, in His time, He makes all things beautiful in His time. Lord, please show me every day as you're teaching me your way that you do just what you say in your time. In your time, in your time, you make all things beautiful in your time. Lord, my life to you I bring, may each song I have to sing be to you a lovely thing in your time.
Amen. You can be seated. All right. I'm going to sing a song that I've sung before. If you're like me, you probably have some friends who don't really believe in God. And I had a friend of mine ask me one time, you know, why do you believe in God? And I realized that I didn't have as good an explanation response that maybe I should have. So thanks to Brother Ben, some things he has said, Jamie, and the book, Lee Strobel, is that his name? Case for Christ. What I urge you to do, if you have doubts, that kind of thing, do some research. It's not blind faith, like Brother Ben said. There's a lot of evidence out there, circumstantial evidence. The more you study it, the more you realize that, you know, this is something that's true. But anyway, it's just like I say, if you have doubts, just get in there and research yourself. Nobody can convince you, but once you really, really realize it yourself, that's when it makes the huge difference for you. All right, this song was written by a member of the Statler Brothers, Jimmy Fortune, the little tenor singer. After his mom passed away, he wrote a song called I believe, pretty simple song, but just expresses his belief in Jesus. When I see the sun rise in the morning, when I feel the wind blow across my face, when I hear the sound of children playing, I know it's all part of God's amazing grace. And I believe there's a place called heaven. And I believe in a place called Calvary. And I believe in a man whose name is Jesus. And I believe that he gave his life for me. I was there the day my mama went to heaven. I held her hand as she closed her eyes to sleep. And I felt the power of 10,000 angels take her soul away to be crowned at Jesus' feet. And I believe there's a place called heaven. And I believe in a place called Calvary. And I believe in a man whose name is Jesus. And I believe that he gave his life for me. Oh, and I believe that he gave his life for me.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Greg. That's a great song. I hope you believe this morning. We'll talk a little bit about that. We're going to be in the book of 1 Peter. There at the end of the New Testament, right before Revelation and 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and of course right before 2nd Peter. 1 Peter chapter number 2, and we're going to read verses 5 and 6 this morning as we think about the house of God. The house of God. 1 Peter chapter number 2, verses 5 and verse number 6. First Peter, chapter number 2, beginning in verse number 5 and verse 6, we find that Peter is writing here under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says, ye also has lively, living is the word, as lively as living stones, are built up a spiritual house
a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the Scriptures, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded." Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer this morning. Father, thank you for the day you've given us, Lord. Thank you for each family, each person that's here in God's house today. Lord, I pray you'd meet with us. Bless this time as we study the Word. We pray Jesus will be lifted up. And Lord, we pray again. You ask you to bless in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, the house of God. You can put your ribbon right here in 1 Peter chapter 2. The house of God, as we'll look at this text and see what we mean. Verse 5 mentions a spiritual house. God as a spiritual house. And you may wonder, what are we talking about? The house of God. Sometimes we even talk about the sanctuary, the building, you know, the house of God there. But we know the best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. And you ought to write in the margin. I don't think you've got it there, but you might. I didn't check. But if you don't have it in your center reference column, write in the margin, 1 Timothy 3 and verse 15, it tells us what is the house of God. 1 Timothy 3 and verse 15 says, "The house of God, which is the church of God, the pillar and ground of the truth." So we talk about the house of God. This morning we're talking about it. We're talking about the local church, Farmington Baptist Church, other Baptist churches here in Graves County and around. We're talking about the church, the house of God, the local visible church. And I want you to look here, and boy, this whole chapter is rich in truths. But I want you to pull three things out. There's a lot more here, but I saw three simple things as we think about the Scripture using the picture, the analogy of a house. God's house, the church, every house of God, every New Testament church, it's got a right base. It's built on a right foundation. I hope that our church is built on the solid rock. It's got a right base. Three B's if you're taking notes. It's made not only the right, it's got a right base. It's made out of bricks. Living stones. The house of God, the church, is made up of living stones. Lively stones. And then last of all, I want you to see it has a brightness to it. So it's base, it's bricks, and it's brightness. Let's think about those three things for a minute this morning. First of all, it's base. You notice there in we find in verse 6 it says, "Wherefore it's contained in Scriptures, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone." Every house has got to have a foundation. If you built the house you're living in now, you remember many of you when we built this building 10 years ago, every building they built, what's the first thing they do? They clear the area where they're going to build it, and they build the foundation first. They put the foundation before the walls, before the roof, before you start framing it up. They've got to get the foundation where it needs to be. The foundation has got to be right. We think about the house of God. We think about the church. What is our foundation? What is our base? We don't have to guess, do we? What did Jesus say? "Upon this rock I will build my church." What is that rock? Well, 1 Corinthians 10 verse 4 says that rock was Christ. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is shifting sand. We're built upon the rock. Our foundation, our base is Jesus. Our church is based upon Jesus. Our church, the foundation of our church is Jesus Christ. What's that mean? All right, that's good preaching in it. It's good songs. There's a lot of songs we sing about that. What's that mean that Jesus is our foundation? We all agree Jesus is the church's foundation. We're built on the solid rock. Christ is our foundation. Well, it reminds us that Jesus is our Lord and Savior. Jesus is somebody we can build our life upon. Jesus is a stable foundation. Jesus is our Lord and Savior. You see in these verses, you notice he uses the word precious twice. Did you catch that? And we see it in verse 6. He says, chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And then we see it again in verse 7. Therefore, unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. Jesus is precious to us. He's our foundation. Jesus is our foundation. What's that mean? He's precious. He died for us. It reminds us Jesus gave His life. We couldn't save ourselves. Jesus loved you. He knew about your sin. He knew about your failures. He knew about your mistakes. He knew me, yet He loved me. And He didn't just tell me He loved me. He didn't just say I love you. He proved His love towards you. God commended His love toward us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. God loved us enough that He died on the cross so we could be saved. He forgave us. He saved us. Jesus is our foundation. We can build our life upon Him. We build our church upon Him. He's the foundation. He's our Lord and Savior. He's the lawgiver. Everything about our church is based upon our foundation. If your foundation crumbles, if your foundation cracks, what happens? Some of you probably have had to repair your foundation of your house, maybe for different things that happen. The house will start shifting. There'll be cracks in the walls. But our church, our life, is all of it is built upon the solid rock. We've got a foundation that is stand. We look to Him. Everything about Him is right. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. His words are truth. His teachings are eternal. His word is pure. We look to Jesus. He's our Lord and Savior. He's the lawgiver. Everything about Him. What is our church to do? What is our church to believe? We don't look to traditions. We don't look to popular opinion, because popular opinion changes every generation, every decade. But God's word is eternal. The grass withers. The flower fades. But what stands forever? God's Word. Jesus is the foundation of our church. He's our Lord and Savior. He's our lawgiver. He's a solid rock we can base our life upon. Jesus won't let you down. He's not a foundation, again, that'll crumble. I was reminded of the great Civil War general, Jeb Stuart, who won many battles, was a great general. Probably some of you will recognize his name. And when he was 31 years old, 1864, he was mortally wounded in the Battle of Yellow Tavern. It was after Gettysburg and he was dying, and he died the next day, and he was taken to a hospital there, and people were gathered around him, and he was at the point of death. And he looked to the people. There was a preacher there and some other people that were there. And he was dying. His last request, he said, "Will y'all sing Rock of Ages?" And you know the old, old song from the 1700s, "Rock of Ages, cleft for me." It gave him hope. It gave him comfort that his life was based on the solid rock. Jesus is a solid foundation. No matter what you're going through, Jesus won't let you down. Let me show you a great verse. I want to turn there. If you're going through trouble, and let's face it, we all go through trouble at different times. Let me show you this verse. I'm going to come back. But I saw this week, and it was a blessing to me. Deuteronomy 31 and verse 8. I oftentimes quote to you, God won't never leave you nor forsake you. That's just part of it. Let me show you a great verse. God doesn't change. So this verse was true in the Old Testament. It's true in the New Testament. It was true yesterday. It's true today. It'll be true forever. Listen to this. Boy, this will give you hope if you're going through trouble in your life. Deuteronomy 31 and verse number 8. Let me get there and I'll read it out loud. Deuteronomy 31 and verse 8, it says, "And the Lord, it is He that goeth before you, before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail you, neither will He forsake you. Fear not, neither be dismayed." God will never forsake you. But that's not all the verse said. It said when you're going through trouble, God's already there. God's in front of you. It says God won't let you down. God's going to be with you no matter what you're going through. Our life is based on the solid rock. Our church is based on the solid rock. What a foundation. All other ground is sinking sand. But Jesus will never let you down in your life no matter what you're going through. He's always going to be there with you. His grace is sufficient. His strength will help you, will encourage you. We've got a base. We've got a foundation as a church and as believers. Our life, our church, our everything is based on the foundation of Jesus Christ. So we see the base, the house of God. It's built upon Jesus. As we say many times, it's all about Jesus. And that's true. Our foundation, where we look to for truth, doctrine, all of that, it all comes from Jesus. But not only the base, let me show you something else that'll be a blessing. You may never have thought about this, but this verse 5, he says, "Ye also has lively stones. 1 Peter 2 and verse 5. Ye also as lively as living stones. The house of God not only has a base, but it's made out of the right bricks. It's made out of certain bricks. Now, Peter, what would his writers, what would his readers be thinking of? They would instantly probably think about Solomon's temple. Solomon's temple, and maybe even Herod's temple. They were made out of stones. They were made out of rock. Craftsmen, they would cut those rocks out and they built a marvelous temple to worship God in. But now Peter says, listen, that was in the Old Covenant. That was the Old Testament. Today, the church is a house of God, just like Solomon's temple and Herod's temple. That was the house of God back then. But now we've got another house of God. And our house of God, it's not built out of bricks. It's not built out of regular wood or stone or mortar or anything like that. It's built out of living stones. What's he talking about? The church is the people. You see, aren't you glad our forefathers knew that? I'm going to tell you, oftentimes, and I tell other preachers all the time, we sometimes think our forefathers weren't that smart. They knew a lot more than we know a lot of times. Our forefathers, when they gave names to things, you ever thought about it? When they came in Graves County, they didn't call it the Graves County Baptist Church. They called it the Graves County Baptist Association. Because what's a church? A local, visible body of baptized believers. The church is the people. It's not a denomination. The church isn't a building. You can look in the foyer and you can see at least four pictures, and there was more before then, of different buildings Farmington Baptist Church has had down through the years. The church isn't a building. The church isn't a denomination. What is the church? The people. You all are Farmington Baptist Church. The people who have made that commitment, who have been saved, follow the Lord in scriptural baptism, made a covenant to join each other. That's the church. That's local visible churches. Where the church, our churches are made up of living stones. Now here's what's great about this. All these stones aren't exactly the same. You know, where I grew up at, once you cross Lake Barkley, the ground is a lot different. And I've told you many times, what the ground on the other side of the lakes is full of rocks. I mean, every year my dad would put the tobacco patch in a different place and I'd have to pick up rocks. And he'd diss that area. And even when I was too little to drive the tractor, every day he'd pull the tractor up another 10 yards, being far as you can pack them. I'll move it up tomorrow. He worked at a public job, and so pick up rocks. Rocks everywhere. My uncle, when I was just a boy, he still lives in this house in Bowling Green. And my uncle, when I was a boy there in the early 80s, he decided to build a two-story rock house. And he went back to my grandfather's house there in Logan County, way back of the place where there were some creeks. And he went back there and he got all the, he didn't have to buy a single rock. He got every rock he wanted to build that two-story, big old nice house, had four kids, room for all of them. He got all the rock he wanted for that rock house back of the place at my grandfather's house. Grandfather's property, rocks everywhere. But if you go, and he still lives it today, all the kids have gone, but him and his wife, my aunt and uncle, still live there today. If you drive up to his house and look at those rocks in that rock house, they're all set in mortar on the side of that house. They're all different, aren't they? They're not all the same color. Different shades of tan, different shades of brown, different shades of gray. They're not all the same shape, the same size. The stones that make up my uncle's house are different. A lot of ways. Same way in the church, isn't it? In every church, we're not all the same. We're all different ages. We've got many young members, lots of young people on this side and other places that are young that have been saved and have joined this church. We've got Miss Pauline, who watches every service on DVD, our oldest member. Brother Junior, right behind her, our oldest man in the church. We've got all different age. We're not all the same age. We didn't all grow up in the same place. We weren't all born in Kentucky. We weren't all born in Graves County. We didn't all grow up the same place. We grew up in different places. We've worked different jobs. We've got different hobbies and interests. We're all different. The church is made up of living stones. We're all different in so many ways. Yet we've got one thing in common. And did you see it? Peter says, I'm going to hit on this twice, because he said, I know y'all going to be like Baptists. You're going to be a little hard-headed. So he hits on it twice. Did you notice the word believe twice? Once in verse 6 and once in verse 7. You're to underline it. You see it there in verse, the last part of verse 6. It says, he that believeth on him. And then you see it again there in verse 7. It says, unto them which believe, he is precious. You got it in the last part of verse 6 and the first part of verse 7. Hits it twice. What's he saying? We're all different in the church. We're made out of different bricks, but there's similarities between us. We've all been saved. Everybody that joins the church has got to say, I've been saved. Now, sometimes people slip in and have never been saved, slip in under false professions. That happens. The first church had Judas in it. But everybody that joins the church has got to say, there's been a time in my life that I trusted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. There's been a time I looked to Jesus. How's a person get saved? Again, you're to underline there at the last part of verse 6, first part of verse 7, those words believe. Everybody gets saved the same way. There isn't a back door to heaven. There isn't a side door into heaven. There's one door by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Everybody that's here this morning, everybody in Graves County, everybody in the world got saved the same way. Different ages, some of them at church, somebody at home, different places, different circumstances, but everybody got saved by believing in Jesus, by trusting Jesus, by coming to that point that you said, I know that I'm lost, I want to be saved, I'm asking Jesus the best way I know how. I'm crying out to Jesus, asking Him to save me. I hope that's happened to you. I hope there's been a time in your life that you believe. And once you've been saved, you can be in the house of God. You can be in the church of God. You can join the church. The church is made up of bricks. We're all different. So many things that are different about us. But we've got one thing in common, Jesus. It's why we could go over to Africa, to China, to South America, any country where they got different culture, different customs, different languages. But you and I, we might not be able to enjoy everything. We might not be able to understand all the songs. Might not be able to understand the preaching. But I've talked to people that were from the backwoods of West Kentucky and went over there, and they said my heart was just joined to their hearts. We had nothing in common, but we had everything in common because of Jesus. The house of God, it's got to have the right base. It's built upon Jesus. It's made out of the right materials, the right bricks. We've all been saved. We've got that in common, Jesus. And then notice one other thing. It's brightness. It's brightness. Now, I was preparing the message. There's so many things we could say. I could preach, and I don't preach a long time. Y'all know that, and I hope you appreciate it. But there's so many things we could talk about. We could talk about how the worship of the church, the spiritual sacrifices. We could talk about the priesthood of the church. We're all have access to God. We could talk about how we all belong to Jesus. We're peculiar. But let me pull one other thing out in the last part of verse 9. That'll be a blessing to you. Look at the last part of verse 9. The Bible says that you should show forth the praises of Him which called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. The brightness. What do we mean? Now that little phrase is packed in truth. God called us out of darkness. When you and I were lost, we couldn't save ourselves. You and I, we were in spiritual darkness. There was no way to get out. Have you ever been down? They would take kids at Farmington to Mammoth Cave, and maybe you've been in a cave somewhere where there's no light. And they get down there, they would take the kids, was it fourth grade or so, to Mammoth Cave. And I did this with Abby and then did it with Olivia. We'd get down in there on the caves, and I remember doing it as a kid myself. And they turn out all the lights, and it's complete darkness. Man, if you were way back in there and they did that, there'd be no way to get out. You and I, we were in darkness. There was no way we could save ourselves. Something had to be done. We're down there wandering around. That's why the Bible says in Romans, there's none that doeth good. There's none that seeketh God. We can't save ourselves. People say, well, surely there's something I can do. I can give some money. You can't give enough money. I can join the church. You can join every church. That won't save you. I can get baptized, take the Lord's Supper, do this, do that. No, we're in darkness, wandering around. We cannot save ourselves. Something had to be done. What happens? We're down there in darkness. We're lost. We're going to stay that way in spiritual darkness. No way to be saved. But what's that verse say? God calls us. Did you see it? God called you out of darkness. We're down there in our lost spiritual condition. No way, we can't save ourselves. Mama can't save us. Granddaddy can't save us. Nobody else can save us. What are we going to do? But God calls. God sees us. God loves us. Jesus died for us, and He begins to call through the voice of the Holy Spirit. He calls through the preaching of the gospel, through the sharing of the gospel, and that Holy Spirit begins to prick our heart. That Holy Spirit begins to deal with us as God is drawing us to be saved. And all of a sudden, we're like, man, I know that I'm lost. I know that I've messed up. I want to be saved. I realize that Jesus can save me. And all we do is we accept the gift. We receive it. We say yes to Jesus. God saves us. He calls us out of spiritual darkness into His light. When you got saved, that happened to you. But there's something else in that one sentence, that last part of verse 9. It's a great truth about salvation, but you say, what's in there about brightness? But look at the rest of it. It said that you should show forth, I'd circle that word show, show forth the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. We should show forth His brightness. They tell us that when the ancient Egyptians built the pyramids, now the pyramids, they've had sandstorms and they're old and, you know, centuries and thousands of years old now, but when the pyramids were originally built by the Egyptians, they were smooth on all four sides. And the pyramids were smooth, and they were not only smooth, they would take that limestone and they would polish it, that when the morning sun came up there in that desert, the sun would reflect off of those pyramids. And everybody, you could see the pyramids from miles and miles away from the reflection of the sun. And I wonder if Peter didn't have something in mind. The Lord, as God is speaking through him, obviously, but Peter, as he wrote this, maybe was thinking about that. We show forth the praises of His Son. You and I are to let others see Jesus in us, right? That's what He's saying. As we go out there, as we are the Lord's church, as we go out there, we're based on the right foundation, we're made out of the right materials, the Lord's bricks, we're to show forth, let others see Jesus in us. As we go to the workplace, go out into the community, go to the schools, wherever we go this week, there's opportunities to shine for Jesus. There's opportunities that people may, we can do things, and people will see, what is it about that person that makes them act like that? Why is that person like that? The Bible tells us in Galatians 6 and verse 10, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all men, especially unto them that are of the household of faith. As you shine for Jesus, as you show forth His brightness, show forth the praises of His Son, show forth God's glory and God's goodness, it'll open doors for you to talk to others about Jesus. People say, why you act like that? You didn't used to act like this. You act different than you used to. What changed? Jesus is what changed. Or as you're telling people about Jesus, it'll back up. Man, there's something different about that person. I want to listen to what they've got to say to me. It'll open doors for you. It'll confirm God's truth as you share the message with others. His brightness. Matter of fact, Matt, you maybe thought about the old 90s song, didn't you? And it's very 90s, but it holds up, I think, the Newsboys, Shine. Shine, it says, the chorus says, shine, make them wonder what you got. Make them wish that they were not on the outside looking in. And that's what we ought to do as we got in the world. Shine for Jesus. That's exactly what He said. Show forth His praises. How many people, so many people in West Kentucky are in church today. They grew up in Christian families. They were brought to church as children, as grandchildren. But there's a lot of other people around us that didn't grow up in church. How'd you get in church? Why are you where you're at today? I saw Jesus in somebody else. And it made me watch that person. It made me ask that person some questions. They told me about Jesus, and God saved me. That's where I'm at today. Jesus made a difference in my life. Let's shine for Jesus. As we have opportunity this week, do good to all men, especially to the household of faith. So Christian, if you've been saved, man, get in the Lord's church. Every Christian, everybody that's saved, there are certain things we don't have to pray about. Everybody that's saved needs to follow the Lord in scriptural baptism. Everybody that's saved needs to be a member of a New Testament church. That's where we serve the Lord. Unto Him be glory in the church. Ephesians 3:21. Throughout all ages, God doesn't have a plan in the 19th century and a different plan in the 21st century. God's plan is the same in all centuries. Since the New Testament, God receives glory in the church. So if you're saved, follow the Lord in scriptural baptism. If you're saved, get in a New Testament church. Make that commitment. I'm going to join with this church. They're going to help me out. I'm going to help them out. We're going to work together to shine for Jesus. Let's serve the Lord. Let's do what God has called us. You that are already here, man, keep on shining for Jesus. Don't hide it under a bushel, but let your light shine for the Lord. But first, remember, what's that one thing we got to have uncommon? You first got to be saved. So if you're here and you've never been saved, there's never been a time in your life that you cried out to Jesus for salvation. Man, do that today. Jesus can save. Jesus can make a difference. Put Him to the test. Jesus will never let you down. He'll make a difference in your life. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the Word of God. I pray it's been a help to us as we thought about these truths about the house of God. I pray You'd bless, Lord. I pray for that one that's lost, whoever it may be, maybe even somebody listening online, that today they would cry out to Jesus and be saved. Lord, I pray for that Christian, maybe it's never been baptized, that they'd follow You and let the world know they've been saved by that public profession, being baptized. I pray that those maybe who haven't joined a church would join a church so they can get in and join with other Christians. And Lord, I pray You'd help all of us that are saved to let our light shine for You, to, Lord, to have an impact on those around us. Bless the invitation. We pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing, Brother Greg.